the turn of the century, there was great poverty and bad housing in Edinburgh. Poverty amongst workers led to the establishment of friendly societies, such as the Ancient Order of Foresters and the Free Gardeners, which still exist today. Such societies help with medical costs, funerals, housing, hardship, and even picnics. However, there was another problem which had to be faced: alcohol. In Edinburgh, there was a pub or beer shop for every 130 inhabitants. This led to the rise of the temperance movement and anti-spirit societies such as the Reekievites. Reekievite teetotal thrift differed from ordinary friendly societies, since their goal was self-reformation, producing the ideal worker. The movement created meeting places and leisure centres where drinking alcohol was prohibited. Finally, during the First World War, laws were brought in controlling the sale of liquor in the pattern we know today. Another social movement of the time was intent on women getting the vote. In those days, women were not allowed to vote in elections. Anger and frustration at this led to the birth of the suffragette movement. There were active supporters throughout Scotland, with dozens of meetings and large demonstrations held in Edinburgh, culminating in October 1909 with an impressive procession along Prince's Street. These were organised by the Women's Social and Political Union, established by the Pankhursts, amongst whose leaders was Flora Drummond, General Drummond to her friends, a Scotswoman who dressed in quasi-military uniform and rode on a horse at the head of all processions. One of those present at the 1909 procession was 9-year-old Bessie Watson, Scotland's youngest lady piper and suffragette. She rode alongside the Countess of Buchan, playing her pipes, and did so on many occasions outside Colton Prison for the suffragettes imprisoned there. Mrs. Pankhurst decided that only militant action would bring the publicity they needed, and so extreme tactics were taken up by the Scots in the autumn of 1912. Windows were smashed, mail damaged, pillar boxes set alight, property targeted, as more and more suffragettes went out seeking arrest, declining to pay fines, and were sent to prison where they embarked on hunger strikes. One such case was the attempt to burn down Kelso Racecourse Grandstand in May 1913 by four women and an elderly man, two of whom were retired missionaries. They were tried and sentenced to imprisonment in Colton Prison. At a demonstration outside the prison on Regent Road, confidence was expressed that they would be out within 9 days, as they were determined to hunger strike. Under the Cat and Mouse Act, they would be freed if they grew weak, but liable for rearrest once they had recovered. With the outbreak of war on 4th of August 1914, suffrage activities were suspended by Mrs. Pankhurst until the end of hostilities, and members of the Women's Social and Political Union were urged to support the war effort.
Oh, we don't want to lose you, but we think you ought to go for your king and your country.
Until 1916, recruiting was voluntary. Edinburgh's voluntary response was the finest in the records of a martial city. Lads raised their ages and many men lowered theirs to enlist. In some stairs, not a fit man was left, and women were left with the terrible problem of making ends meet. A recruiting tram car decorated with posters and flags was stationed at two main sites, Waterloo Place and Toll Cross. Recruits could enlist on the spot. Officers, MPs, and often soldiers on leave from the front spoke of their experiences and encouraged them to enlist. With so many men going off to the army, women were called on to undertake all manner of work, hitherto men's work, from bus conductors, bank clerks, rolling out barrels in breweries, to working in munitions factories. There were also those who became directly involved in the conflict as doctors and nurses, treating mustard gas casualties and men suffering from malaria, dysentery and blackwater fever. One such woman was Dr. Elsie Ingalls, who set up Scottish women's hospitals in France and Serbia. She and hundreds of other ordinary women had given triumphant proof of their capabilities as well as their patriotism and could be denied the vote no longer. On 6th of February 1918, women over 30 got the vote. The reason why the vote was restricted was to prevent an immediate women's majority in the electorate. 10 years later, June 1928, women became eligible to vote on exactly the same grounds as men. Politics after the Great War was greatly affected by the changes in voting laws, as can be seen by looking at how the voting patterns across the city changed over the years. In the first municipal elections after the First World War, the electorate had grown to double that of pre-war years due to the great addition of women to the register. However, Labour, or the Socialists as they were known, did not fare well. As the Scotsman gleefully stated, there was a total defeat of the Labourists. Not one of their candidates all over the city were elected. The people who were elected did not belong to political parties as such. They were individuals who were elected according to their reputation or the promises they made to the voters. They generally fell into the category of liberal Tories. In 1923, a popular Labour chorus was, "Yes, we have no homes, but we'll have some when Labour is returned." This was in the days before council housing. The Communists made an appearance in the city and drew a good poll in St Leonard's and South Leith, where they took the vote which usually went to Labour. 1924 was the start of the big splits between Labour and Communism. Labour got into power nationally for the first time as a minority government and were frequently accused of being in league with Moscow. They were in for 10 months before they fell from power. This was reflected by their support in the municipal elections. There was a poor turnout for the polls in 1929, but many of those who did come out were voting Labour. Nationally, Labour's fortunes were up too. They entered their second term of office at Westminster. However, the Great Depression was about to start. In 1931, many of the opposing candidates had gathered together under the banner of the moderates, and Labour's fortunes were down. Nationally, Labour had fallen from power in Westminster, and in London, Oswald Mosley had left the Labour Party to form the British Union of Fascists. The Depression was biting deeper and unemployment was rising. Over successive years, Labour had failed to develop Scottish Home Rule when it was in office, and as a result, in 1932, a new party was born, which had this as their major objective, the Scottish National Party. However, they didn't seem to be taking votes away from Labour, more from the moderates. 1934 saw another boost to Labour's fortunes in the city, but a new force had appeared which was to become a serious challenge, the Protestant Action Society. More people were coming out to vote. In North Leith, the turnout went up from 31% to 58%, and most of the increased turnout went to John Cormack, leader of the Protestants. In 1935, the poll across the city was up from 40% to 50%. Many of the extra votes were going to the Protestants, though it's possible that as many as 10% of Labour's voters were switching to the Protestants. 1936, and the battle was heating up. The Protestants took six of the seats they contested, and in several parts of the city it was developing into a struggle between the Protestants and Socialists for power. Canongate and Gorgie were two areas where voters defected from Labour to the Protestants. 1937 saw the entrance of another new party in local politics, the Fascists. However, Labour were winning. For the first time ever, they polled more than the opposing Progressives. Voters were coming back from the Protestants to Labour too. In 1938, the recession was really over, and Scottish unemployment was down to 15%. The pattern was set from now on for a decline in Protestant fortunes and a slow rise for Labour. Indeed, in the space of 20 years, the Labour vote in the city had grown from 15 to 43% of the poll. It was emerging to become one of the major forces in the party political system we know today. The general strike of 1926 was a climax to several years of industrial unrest, in which miners' unions sought sympathetic support from workers in other industries. Miners called for a strike because mine owners wanted longer hours for less pay. Miners' leader A.J. Cook's motto was,
"Not a penny off the pie, not a second on the dime."
By the deadline of the 3rd of May 1926, local union officials had called out transport, printers, builders and heavy industrial workers. Workshops were deserted. Baldwin's government used troops to retain food supplies and recruited volunteers to run transport. These people were known to the strikers as scabs. They were mainly students and were at that time from the upper classes. Stones and bricks were thrown at the trams when these scabs took the trams out of the depot. Mounted police began to be a common sight at this time. Corporation workers were warned that if they went on strike, they would lose their jobs to the unemployed. The strike went on for 9 days, and by the end of it, the miners were no better off. They decided to stay out, but by August, they returned to work for longer hours and less pay.
Then 26, a general strike, found me out on the streets. Though I'd a wife and kids been then, the needs I had to meet. Now a brand new world was coming, with a brotherhood of man. When the struggle that was over, we were back where we began.
During the interwar years, unemployment in Scotland was high. There was deep poverty, severe overcrowding and poor diets. Depression was due to the after effects of the war and domestic economic recession. Scottish communists and socialists organised marches in 1922, 1929 and 1932. There were protest marches against the government. They were called hunger marches. The best remembered in Edinburgh was in 1933. Marchers from the west and north of Scotland arrived off the boat at South Queen's Ferry on the 13th of June 1933 to walk the last few miles into the city. They were campaigning against unemployment and an end to the means test. To make their point, they sent a deputation to interview the heads of the government department when they stopped at Drumshoe Gardens. While the interview went on, 1,000 demonstrators squatted in the streets. After the meeting, they went to Parliament Square, where they were given food from the travelling kitchen. The Edinburgh Reception Committee was in charge of securing accommodation and food for the marchers, but the Tory Town Council refused permission for this, so they had to bed down in Princes Street. This made the council look pretty foolish. Next day, the marchers were given bananas from a sympathetic grocer's in Leith. 1,500 banana skins were left hanging on the railings right along Princes Street as a memento of the hunger marchers in Edinburgh.
The Protestant boys are loyal and true, they're hearted in battle and sight and true. The Protestant boys are true as of yore, and faithful and peaceful and dangerous though. And no, they bear...
In the 16th and 17th centuries, Scotland had become one of the most Protestant states of Europe, and the east of Scotland in particular. However, the influx of Irish Catholics through the 1800s meant that by 1933, 9% of the population of Edinburgh were Catholics. In the 1920s, a man came to Edinburgh who was to exploit the situation, John Cormack, a Highlander who had joined the army and fought against the IRA in the Anglo-Irish War of 1919. There he had developed a hatred for Catholic priests. After the war was over and Ireland got its independence, Cormack came back to work in Edinburgh and soon became involved in Protestant societies. From 1930, Cormack became a well-known orator at the Mound denouncing Catholics. Catholics lived mainly in Leith and the Grassmarket, and in 1933, Cormack began to hold meetings in these areas, especially at the foot of Leith Walk. In 1934, he became a councillor for North Leith. His manifesto read, "Stop state funding for Catholic education, get rid of Catholics who were officers in the forces, and the removal of Catholics from the law." In 1935, Edinburgh District Council was hosting a civic reception for the Catholic Young Men's Society. The Daily Press carried an advertisement calling Protestants to gather outside the city chambers at 7 p.m. It was said to be the tensest night since the general strike. 10,000 people gathered to heckle Catholics as they arrived. Attempts were made by the Protestant Action Society to march into the Cowgate. Catholics regarded this as very serious, and large numbers of young Catholics guarded both St. Patrick's and St. Mary's Cathedral.
After that great hill they were ranked on every side, and offering up their papish prayers for help to stem the tide. But we loosed our guns upon them and quickly won the day, and we knocked 500 papishes right over Dolly's Brae.
In 1936, the Protestant Action Society's greatest triumph was when they got 9 seats on the town council. Immediately problems arose. Protestant Action councillors were unable to see eye to eye, and so the party began to split up. Cormac disbanded the executive committee and took control of the party himself. He readily accepted the mantle of dictator. But his dictatorial style, coupled with the accusations of financial mismanagement, led to a drop in his support. Protestant Action councillors left the party to become independent councillors, and the arrival of the Second World War brought national unity. Over successive years, Protestant Action lost its force, and now John Cormac is only remembered by the Orange Lodge.
Oh, fatherland, fatherland, show us a sign, your children are ready to see. The morning will come when the world is mine. Tomorrow be lost, tomorrow be lost, tomorrow be lost to me.
In the 1930s, a new political force was emerging all over Europe, fascism. In Edinburgh, Sir Oswald Mosley of the British Union of Fascists, with his paramilitary defence force, the Black Shirts, held a meeting in the 2,500 people attended, and 2,000 to 3,000 collected outside, along with protesting communists. Police on horseback broke up the communist groups, but by the end of the meeting, the crowd had regathered, and although Mosley left unobserved, his stewards met with a hostile reception as they boarded buses, resulting in smashed windows and some injured. Further street fighting broke out in Tow Cross. Left-wing socialists saw the British Union of Fascists as one of the signs of an impending revolutionary situation, and a pattern of violence and counter-violence followed. In 1936, socialist demonstrators in Edinburgh turned their attention to Spain. A republican government had been elected at a time of social unrest, and the Spanish army generals reacted, led by Franco, and organised a coup. Western governments refused to get involved and turned a blind eye to Hitler and Mussolini sending troops and arms in to support Franco. Socialists in Edinburgh resolved to support the Republicans' cause in their fight against fascism. Over 500 Scots volunteered to serve in the international brigades alongside 30,000 men from 29 nations.
The people's on the march, the strut upsetting. It's lit the freedom, it's lit the freedom. The people's on the march, the strut upsetting. It's lit the freedom and liberty. Banner of the lads, the young.
In 1936, the British government had not yet taken steps to prevent volunteering, so reaching Spain was not a problem. But by 1938, it had been made illegal and often required crossing the Pyrenees on foot, avoiding French frontier police. Many had no previous military training and spent maybe 6 weeks before facing fierce and formidable units of Spanish Foreign Legion, Moroccan units, and German and Italian fascists in action. This happened at the Battle of Jarama, the first major engagement of the British Battalion in February 1937, in which out of 700, only 150 had not been wounded by day two.
There's a valley in Spain called Jarama. It's a place that we all know so well. It was there where we gave up our manhood, where so many of our brave comrades fell. Now we're proud of the British Battalion and the stand for Madrid that it's made, where we fought like two sons of the soil as part of the 15th Brigade.
Many were taken prisoner and forced to witness the execution of their comrades. However, they were eventually repatriated and warned they would be shot if they returned. Many did return and were indeed recaptured and shot. The ill-fated Ebro crossing was the first action for some, where three-quarters of the brigade's men were lost under heavy artillery fire. It was a brilliantly conceived operation which might have altered the course of the war if the Republicans had had the air power, armour and heavy artillery needed to give the brigade support. Decisions to withdraw the international brigades were made, and by November 1938, most had returned to face discrimination at home. They were considered communists for fighting in Spain. When World War II came a few months after the fall of Spain, Britain found itself in the same purgatory to which it had abandoned the Spanish people, alone against fascism. At 11 a.m. on the 3rd of September 1939, Chamberlain's declaration of war was broadcast. An hour later, air raid sirens sounded throughout the city and people ran for shelter. However, this was to prove a false alarm and signalled the start of what was to be called the phony war. However, the months that followed were vital in allowing British factories to produce necessary military equipment. Blackout regulations were enforced, places of entertainment shut down, gas masks issued and Anderson shelters and stirrup pumps delivered. Trenches lined Princes Street and mounds of sandbags lay in front of public buildings. Evacuations were well underway. A total of 30,000 people, mainly mothers and children, had left the city in the biggest exodus in the city's history. Men and women were volunteering for the services, and women were being bombarded with appeals to join the war effort, to take up active service in the auxiliary armed forces, Royal Ordnance Factories, Women's Land Army, Civil Defence, and in hospitals and ambulance corps. Munitions and aeroplane factories especially needed women to take over men's work. Such were the demands of the war effort.